You've done it again, Lord. You've done it again. You are good and you are mighty and you are merciful. And you keep taking care of me when I don't deserve it. Praise you, Jesus. You are Lord. Give me another one, Lord. Guide me to who you want me to help. Raise up more that will call upon your name. Raise up those that love you and seek you and trust you. Raise them up, Lord. Raise them up. Lord, we need a generation of believers who are not ashamed of the gospel. We need an army of believers, Lord, that hate to be lukewarm and will stand on your word above all else. Raise them up, Lord. Raise them up. I pray for unity among those that love you. I pray that you open their eyes so that they can see your truth, Lord. I pray for your hand of protection and guidance. Raise up a generation, Lord, that will take light into this world, that will not compromise when under pressure, that will not cower, Lord, when others fall away. Raise them up, Lord, that they will proclaim that there is salvation in the name of Jesus Christ. Raise up warriors, Lord, who will fight on their knees, who will worship you with their whole hearts, Lord. Lord, call us to battle, that we may proclaim you King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I pray these things with all.
All right, High Rock Church of Lexington, how are you doing? Good to see you. It's good to be here. We're going to be in Colossians chapter 2 this morning, and we're going to continue our series on spiritual warfare. Let's just pray real quick. God, I just thank you for your word. I ask that you make it plain to us in our hearts and our minds, and I ask that you move us to greater obedience and greater character, godly character that models who you are. In your name, amen. We are in Colossians chapter 2, and Paul begins this passage. He's a verse or two before, and he says, I do not want you to be deceived. I do not want you to be tricked into thinking things that are wrong, and I want you to proceed correctly and know what you need to know. Information is a big problem for us in our society right now, isn't it? We don't know what to believe. One side says this, another side says that, and they both tell, pointing fingers at each other, you're liars. And it's just hard, isn't it? And Paul understands that it's hard for us as Christians to know what is true, and he writes this passage to us to give us the information that we need. And he says in Colossians 2, beginning in verse 9, for in Christ all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form. And in Christ you have been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and authority. In him you were also circumcised with a circumcision not performed by human hands. Your whole self, ruled by the flesh, was put off when you were circumcised by Christ. Having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead. When you were dead in your sins and in the circumcision of your flesh, God made you alive in Christ, and he forgave us all of our sins, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He has taken it away, and he has nailed it to the cross. And having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Therefore, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink or with regard to a religious festival, a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. These are a shadow of the things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ. Do not let anyone who delights in false humility and the worship of angels disqualify you. Such a person also goes into great detail about what they have seen. They are puffed up with idle notions by their unspiritual mind, and they have lost connection with the head, from whom the whole body, supported and held together by its ligaments and sinews, grows as God causes it to grow. Since you died with Christ to the elemental spiritual forces of this world, why, as though you still belong to this world, do you submit to its rules? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. These rules, which have to do with things that are all destined to perish with use, are based on merely human commands and teachings. Such regulations indeed have an appearance of wisdom. With their self-imposed worship, their false humility, and their harsh treatment of the body, but they lack any value in restraining sensual indulgence. See, God understands that it seems easier for us to navigate this life by adding something to Jesus in our relationship with Him other than Jesus. God knows that this is a struggle that we have. And He understands that it is difficult for us, and that is why we have this passage here. Because it is hard for us to live on Jesus alone, and it's easy for us to mix other things into our relationship with Christ. And this is what the people in Colossae were doing. They were mixing their Christian worship and their pagan worship together, and they were having troubles fitting in, and getting it right, because it was easier to rely on the things that they were used to. But here in this passage, Paul tells us that Jesus is God and the head of all things. And he expects us to live, because Jesus is God and the head of all things, we should live just as if all we need is Jesus. Okay? So because Jesus is God and the head of all things, we should live just like Jesus is all that we need. And that's what this passage is about. And so it begins with in Christ, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form. And all this fullness, that means there's nothing left out. It's not just the divine qualities of God. It's His essence as well is with Jesus. And it's not just what He can do and what He looks like, but it is who He is. His essence is included in this fullness. And I tried to figure out how to explain this a little bit, talk about it. This probably falls short, but we all are familiar with Advil and aspirin, right? They're in the same family of medications. They're pain relievers, and they reduce inflammation. And so they're the same family. They do the same thing. You can take one or the other. The result is the same, but they are not the same. So Jesus is not like Advil and God is like aspirin. Jesus has all the qualities of God. He does all the things that God does. He looks like God, but not only that, He is actually God. And that is what is being said here when it talks of all the fullness in bodily form. The construction of the sentence in here, the sentence structure in here, indicates that this was true before Jesus had a body. All the fullness dwelled in Him before He had a body, and it continues. And it points to the fact that it continues beyond Jesus just having a body at the incarnation. It continues and lets us know that Jesus still has a body and He possesses everything that God is, all His fullness, His character, how He works, what He does, His decision makings, what He looks like, and who He is at His core. This is our Jesus. And the fullness then is given to us. And so Jesus is God, the head of all things, and He is the source of our identity. In verses 9 through 15. Just as Jesus is the fullness of God, he has brought us into our own fullness. And because we are identified with him and we have relationship with him, he has opened up the way for us to have our own fullness, to be exactly and fully what God has designed and made us to be. Jeremiah 31:33. I'm just going to go to my phone once. I didn't get this one in. We're going to start actually in verse 31. Jeremiah says, "The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt, because they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them." You get that? It's not going to be the same because we broke it. "This is the covenant I will make with the people of Israel. After that time, declares the Lord, I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they will be my people." Jesus is the source of our identity. We are identified with Christ in three ways in this passage. It says, by circumcision, baptism, and resurrection. We are circumcised in our heart. No, and it says, in him you were also circumcised in verse 11 with a circumcision not performed by human hands. Your whole self ruled with the flesh was put off when you were circumcised by Christ. Now, that sounds to us in English like Christ does the circumcision. He does not. It's just an identification that this is Christian circumcision. It's spiritual circumcision. It's circumcision of our heart. And the picture is a little difficult, especially for men, but it's here. And it says, when your whole self ruled by the flesh was put off when you were circumcised. So the old flesh was torn back, and what God created and intended to be is now exposed to live for Christ. This is the circumcision of our hearts, where the old self and our sin that covered over what God has created is pulled back and removed, and we are brought into our fullness to live for him. We are identified with Christ in our baptism. Now, this is not a picture of baptism. This is a reference to the actual rite of baptism, where you're dunked under the water, buried with Jesus in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life. This is a direct reference to this act that we perform. We perform it here at this church, the rite of baptism. This identifies us publicly with Jesus Christ. So we are circumcised and we are exposed to where we can live for God, and then we are identified with Christ publicly by being baptized. This is why baptism is the first thing in the Great Commission. It's part of the Great Commission. Baptize these people in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. And we are identified with Christ in resurrection to life. We are made alive in his power. And so with this identification with God, we are given this completeness. We don't need anything other than Jesus. That's all we need. It's complete. It is complete. Remember when you used to buy something that was complete? It seems like forever ago, right? Now when you buy something, you always have to buy something else to make it work, right? You buy a computer, you need to get software so you can use it, right? You buy toys, what do you need to buy with them? Batteries. They don't work without the batteries, and they don't give you the batteries. You know? There was a time when you could buy something, and it was complete. We have this when Jesus purchases us. He purchases us wholly, and we are made complete in fullness. We are changed. Our old ways of coping are not needed anymore. I do not need alcohol to get me through the day. I do not need to eat all sorts of sugary foods to get me through the day. I do not need to go shopping to medicate whatever's bothering me and buy something. All this old stuff has passed away. I do not need to gossip so that I feel better about myself. I have Jesus. These old ways of coping with life are no longer needed. And I am made alive and in power. And this results in confidence. And confidence instead of fear. We have forgiveness of our sins, a canceled debt, and our enemies are disarmed and embarrassed publicly because of what Jesus has done on the cross. There are no grudges that can be held against you because Jesus died, paid our debt. We don't owe anything to anybody anymore. Jesus has taken care of it all. This is why Satan cannot come before God and accuse you as a believer in Christ. Because there's nothing there to accuse you of. Jesus has taken care of all of it. Not only that, our enemies are disarmed. They have no weapons. Our enemies have no weapons. They have no authority over us. Sometimes we give them authority back, but they have no authority over us. They have no weapons with which to fight us with. And God just paraded them publicly, so to speak, impotent in front of everyone, so that we could be justified. So that we could be made whole. And so we don't have this fear, right? Nobody fears when they don't owe anybody anything. Nobody fears when there's nothing that you can be accused of. Nobody fears when your enemies are powerless and don't have anything to fight you with. We have this confidence to move forward and to trust God. And so Jesus is the source of our identity. We identify with Him. And Him only, and nothing else. Verses 16 through 19, Jesus is the source of our maturity. It says, therefore, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to a religious festival, or a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. He's saying, do not let anyone judge you by your religious practices. And I'm saying that he also means do not judge yourself by your religious practice either. The Jewish system had a whole system of things to worship God with. You could eat certain things, you couldn't eat other things, you could drink certain things at certain times. There were festivals, there were celebrations, there was obedience to a whole set of rules that were outside of the Old Testament. And, you know, if you did these things, you kept your life pure and before God. We also have our own system. We have obedience to rules, right? We have certain rules that we set up. Christians don't do this. Christians don't do that. We go to Bible studies, extra Bible studies and whatnot, maybe. We pride ourselves in our service. We're going to serve others. We're going to love other people. We're going to have our quiet time every week. Do not judge yourself by your religious practice. None of these things in and of themselves are spiritual activities. They seem spiritual, but on their own, they are not spiritual activities. God's own system of cultic worship in the Old Testament is something that Jesus replaced. Hebrews 10 says the law is only a shadow of the good things that are coming, not the realities themselves. For this reason, it can never, by the same sacrifices repeated endlessly, year after year, make perfect those who draw near to worship. Otherwise, would they not have stopped being offered? For the worshipers would have been cleansed once for all and would no longer have felt guilty for their sins. But those sacrifices are an annual reminder of sins, because it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. This does not mean that the Old Testament does not apply. What it does mean is that our activities do not make us spiritual. My Christianity is real, not by what I do, but by who I am. My identity with Christ. I cannot force it to be true. I cannot make it true by doing something. My identity is real by who I am. So, I'm a Yankee, right? So, you say, well, yeah, we can tell by the way you speak, but when I go home, they think I sound like a Southerner. So, but I can change the way I talk. Now, I can eat grits. And I can drive my pick-em-up truck. I can like collards. I even know what a toboggan is. And it ain't a sled. But you're all sitting there going, he's still a Yankee. Right. Because you have to be born and bred Southern to be a true Southerner. You have to be born from the South. The same is true for our Christianity. What we do and what we look like does not make us Christian. It's who we are. It's whether we have, as the old Baptist preachers used to say, been born again. Have we been born again? Are we born of God by water and spirit? Notice another reference to baptism, water. And spirit. Only Christ sits in judgment of my spirituality and my Christianity. He is the source. Listen to what Jesus says to the Pharisees, the smartest people on the planet in Jesus' day when it comes to the Scriptures and understanding them. He says, you study the Scriptures diligently in John 5:39, because you think that in them you have eternal life. These are the very Scriptures that testify about me, yet you refuse to come to me to have life. Jesus is the only source of our maturity. What I do does not make me Christian. I am Christian because I am born again, and that affects what I do. The order is important. You don't get to God by doing. You come to God and then you do. And we will never wage war in this world, and we will never win spiritual battles until we understand this. It is about who we are, not what we do. Do not allow your personal experiences to con you into thinking you are spiritually mature. This is in the verse. In verse 18, do not let anyone who delights in false humility and the worship of angels disqualify you. Such a person has lost connection with the head. Do not let your personal experiences con you into thinking you are spiritually mature. It's called false humility. Angel worship, dreams, visions, gifts, talents, worship experiences. Seeing God work in blessings in your finances, in your spiritual life, in the outcome of health conditions. Anyone who believes that these things equal maturity has lost connection with Christ. They do not. Our experiences do not equal maturity. No, there are only two biblical rites of passage. A rite of passage is, when you turn 16 and you get your license, that's a rite of passage. When you turn 21 and you go to your first bar, that's a rite of passage. These are rites of passage. Well, in terms of the Bible, there are two rites of passage. Baptism, the actual act of baptism, being dunked in the water, buried with Jesus in baptism, and raised to walk in newness of life. This is your first rite of passage. This is why it is commanded in the Great Commission. And this is your first act of obedience. The second rite of a passage is obedience. And you must know it's obedience. It's not doing something. There are a lot of good things we do. You know, we can serve people all day long, but that is not a spiritual endeavor on its own. The Peace Corps should let us know that. It's being obedient to what God has called us to do. And some things that we do are good things, but maybe God's not calling us. So it's the obedience that's the part. It's not what we do. That is our rite of passage. Only Scripture can disqualify us. My growth and my maturity is real, not by my experiences, personal or religious, but by how deeply Christ has infected my person, like a cancer that eats away at us until there's nothing left but Jesus. Not my personal experiences. I cannot make this happen. Only Christ in Scripture can disqualify us. There's no secret knowledge. There's no special program. There's no experience to seek. Just Jesus. No, that's hard, right? But God understands this is hard, and that's why He's telling us. It has to be Jesus only. What I experience does not make me mature. I am mature because Christ develops His fruit and His character in me, and that affects how I handle my experiences because of who Christ is in me. Jesus is the source of our identity. He is God, the head of all things, the source of our identity. He is the source of our maturity. In verses 20 through 23, He is the source of our transformation. And this transformation is from acting Christian to becoming Christian. We died with Christ. It says there in verse 20, since you died with Christ to the elemental spiritual forces of this world, why, as though you still belong to the world, do you submit to its rules? We died with Christ. This again, from the Greek text, is a reference to the act of baptism. It's our identity with Jesus. And Paul says, well, why would you live in one world and work in another? Why would you live in a world of freedom and work in a world of bondage? Why wouldn't you work in the world of freedom? And so he says, if you have Jesus, why are you going back to these things? Why are you going back to these rules to transform you? The rules here do not equal the Old Testament law. If we look at verse 22, it says it's human commands. It probably refers to the difficulties that the people of Colossae were having. It also probably refers to Jewish midrash and commentary from the Old Testament. And there was a lot of it, and it created a lot of rules. And these are some of the things that Jesus talked about when he was confronting them. And so this rules does not equal the Old Testament law. The rule still applies. The Old Testament still applies. But instead of following the rules, we follow Christ. And the goal of the rules then is accomplished. It's just Christ, not our rules. Just Jesus. Just like in Hebrews 10, right? These are just a symbol, a sign, a shadow of the good things that are coming in Jesus. Rules are about temporary things as well, aren't they? God wants us to be about eternal things. So if we say, well, you know, as a Christian, you don't cuss. That's about temporary things. That's about looking Christian at the moment. It's not about eternal things. When I was a framing carpenter, you know, I'd get shot in the hand or in the leg with a 16-penny nail with a nail gun, boom. Have to take a hammer to yank it out of my body. And never cuss. That was the biggest witness on that whole job site. These guys are like, what? How did he know? I knew. You know, and they'd say, I thought for sure you were going to cuss on that one, you know? But it's about temporary things. The rule is about, I'm not going to cuss. It's a temporary thing. The real focus should be the eternal thing, the character of God, self-control and gentleness, both characters violated by the act of cussing. Lack of self-control, definitely not gentle. Do you see? The rule is not focus. It's God Himself. It's Jesus. And the rules are about temporary things. And look at how Paul gives these things unflattering descriptions. They have an appearance. They're self-imposed. They're false. They're harsh. They are ultimately unhelpful because they do not fix what ails us. They are a shadow of the substance God wants us to have. They result in an earned humility. I have done what God has asked me to do. I deserve God's blessing. This earned humility, which is no humility whatsoever. It's a substance. It's a shadow. It's a lie. It's false. My growth and my maturity is real, not by my experiences, religious or personal, but how deeply Christ has infected me. And our goal then, which cannot be accomplished by these rules, is that God is to restrain our sensual indulgence. Only Christ can restrain sensual indulgence. Only Christ can transform us so that we do more than act Christian, but we actually become Christian. So that I am not just someone who is patient, but I'm someone who has become patient in my character. Jesus is the source of our identity, our maturity, and our transformation, and we cannot add anything to it to get it. And we're concerned about the source of things now, right? Where things come from, is this made in China or is this made in the United States, you know? I only drink coffee harvested by Juan Valdez. I only buy my arugula from a organic grocer, right? Where did this meat come from? Is it an organic farm, or did they feed these cows and just let them sit? We're concerned about all this source. And in our spiritual life, we need to be concerned about the source, because it can only be Jesus. Any mixture taints what we have and sets us back. But God understands it just feels better sometimes to mix other things into our relationship with Him. Worldly wisdom, second plans. Now, here's my backup plan if God doesn't come through the way I want. We all do it, right? But all that taints what we have with God. Let's pray. God, I thank you that you are kind and generous and patient. Your patience with us. Thank you so much. Thank you that you are able to save us, and you are able to make us like you. You are able to give us hope and character. You're able to give us the strength and the courage that we need to just trust you and you alone.